our second Sunday of Advent and preparing for Christmas, and we're on the Prepare the Way lesson today, and so we're looking forward to that, and this is all a part of us leading up to the Christmas season. And so you have announcements before you today, and just a note to those who are on email about the Joint Dean's Report this week, and there are hard copies for people at the back window. And this will be dealt with in the new year, but since it was done, we wanted to get it out to people. So that's good from the Jordan Dean's committee and our reps on that. And thanks to everybody for the bazaar yesterday, a great time. Lots of breakfast served and lots of good times. And so we have some note about that.
Thank you for the kitchen cooks say it was a fun day. Sheffield folks, you rock. I just begin to make everyone a many, many thanks to those who attended or helped out in any way with this year's talk. Many hours of planning and hard work paid off. Best of all, where the talent shared, the friendships formed, and the fellowship enjoyed. This announcement's in a three-point form, like good sermons, right? First, you will find a few remaining items for sale downstairs after church, including frozen turkey pot pies and frozen apple pies. Secondly, as there is a quantity of pancake mix remaining, everyone is invited to stay after church for free pancake lunch today. Jennifer has graciously offered to flip the pancakes, and so you'll see her and her helper leave a little early in service today. And lastly, our bazaar last year raised $1,500. So I'm delighted to report that yesterday we raised $2,025. And so that part about the three-point sermon, we were kind of sharing downstairs that a number of us are feeling a bit rattled today, and a little, like, there's a lot of things happening, and at Rock, and when I left the office before the service there, I couldn't find the second page of my sermon notes, and I did discover them then after I went in, after the Rockland service, so you'll get them. That's always the story, is that somebody on the two-point charge will land in the second point and go, I left my notes in the other church. I haven't had that happen yet, and if they did, I think I'd be able to add that something right. Anyway, we have other announcements. I know Marty had an announcement, and Jenny has an announcement.
I just think that we should all talk to the playground. Oh, so the bazaar,
Santa, thing raising gifts for the family through the Flamborough Food Bank. We're really impressed with how well people responded to that, and all the gifts have been done, and then some. So thanks very much. And if you haven't brought them in today, if you still got them at home, then you can talk to Helen or I about getting them in, because we have to deliver them to the food bank this week. So thank you very much for that. And the other thing, Reverend Ken sent out an email this week about Syrian refugees. So for those of you who not on email. There's a couple of ways, simple ways, if you want to give money to help Syrian refugees, you can go to the Canadian Food Grain Bank website, and donations there go to the refugees in Syria or in Jordan or Lebanon, and it's matched 4-1 by the Canadian government. And then you can also go on the Wesley Urban Ministries website, and money donated to them goes to helping refugees that are coming to Canada. And they also have a message on there that once refugees start arriving in Hamilton, that there will be a need for household items and various things, but they are not ready to receive those yet. But when they do open that up, we are going to try to take part in that and collect things here. So just keep that in mind for down the road. And they're looking for housing space as well. Anybody? So you can talk to Helen or I about any ideas you have there. All right, thanks.
We'll be hearing more about refugees next week because we will be having some activities around that. So we'll talk about that next week. And any other announcements that we need to make for today? Isaiah 40, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Let us join in prayer. O God, you loved us so much that you came to us in a person. We celebrate this time of the coming of Jesus into our world. We remember before you the humble birth that lifts up all who are humbly born and puts down the proud and the arrogant. Give us the grace now in worship that we may show the same love and humility, that it may rule in our hearts and govern our actions through Jesus the Christ. Amen. We have the candle of peace today.
You want to do the first hymn first?
Oh, yes.
Let's do number 20 first then, on your command.
Oh, yeah.
me hear what the Lord, what God the Lord will speak. For he will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts. Surely his salvation is at hand for those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Can you hear it?
What is it?
God's word is coming.
We're listening. We're eager to hear.
A voice cries out and declares the promise of peace.
We stand in awe.
Things are going to even out in our world.
All people will embrace each other.
Today we light the candle of peace.
Christmas is getting closer all the time.
Yeah, I have a star at home, and it's a red and green pattern. Every day,
for that and for all the things at Christmas. Now, one of the things that we do at Christmas is that we like to give gifts and support people who are in need. And so we had our special project of the Secret Santa, and everybody was buying gifts for the family that we want to support. We've been really generous in that and really good. And today, people have brought white gifts. And that's a reminder about how we have lots and we want to make sure that everybody has enough in this time. And so we bring food and gifts, and so they get divided between the Glenboro Food Bank and the West Irwin Ministries. And so we're glad for that. So does anyone out there have white gifts that you want to... Oh, okay, so if you could go all over and get the white gifts and we'll put them up there under the tree.
The gospel reading this morning is Luke 3, year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, and Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of the region of Etruria and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, tetrarch of Abilene. In the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. And he went into all the region above the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be brought low. And the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways shall be made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God.
Along came an old soldier who was bent and cold.
and he knocked on the door. And Martin invited him in and gave him some hot soup and then sent him on his way. And he watched longer, and a woman with a baby came shivering and knocked on his door. And Martin let her in, gave her some clothes, and fed her a meal. And as he watched longer, an old apple woman humped over came to his door, and he took her in and gave her a meal. And he watched, and he watched, but no one else came. During the night, he heard a voice. "Martin, do you not know me?" And Martin replied, "Who are you?" "Even I." And as the night went on, the old soldier came to him in a vision and said, "It is I," and vanished. And the woman with the baby came to him in a vision and said, "It is I," and disappeared. And the old humped over apple woman came to him in a vision and said, "It is I," and then disappeared. And Martin realized that Jesus had indeed visited him. And he got the message, of the gospel that Jesus is present in even the least of these. There are many messengers of the faith for us. The faith is about hearing the story. The message is about how we meet Jesus and other people, sometimes the most humble that there are. I know it's always a challenge for us to know how to approach various people within our world today. Now, for those of us who travel in urban areas, often we're stopped at a street waiting to be able to get on to the next road, and someone with a sign will say, "Help me out, I'm hungry, God bless." And we never know quite how to support. We can rationalize that, well, our buck or two wouldn't help that much, or that are they doing really well and others on welfare and maybe more needy are staying with whatever they get that is given to them. There are questions, of course, about all of the trials that we have around the world today and the millions of displaced people who feel they are without a country. And we don't know quite how to approach them and how we deal with the sheer numbers of people who are refugees in our time. How do we get to see the face of Jesus in all the people around the world in need? This gets told in a story, a fable, about a messenger sent by a king. He was asked to deliver a message that was really vital to the kingdom. And he was to take it to a governor in a far distant city. And so the messenger was concerned that he'd be able to convey the message accurately and clearly. And so he rehearsed it and recited it so that he would be able to remember it and know it well and to be able to pass it on accurately to the governor some days down the road. He knew that if he wasn't able to deliver that message accurately, that he was the agent of the king, after all, and there would be big consequences if he had made a mistake. And so he set out on the journey several days across the kingdom. And he rehearsed the lines over and over so that he would not forget them. The first day went fairly well. There were lots of things along the road to distract him, but he got to the evening and the night before bed. He recited the message and thought that it was reasonably clear in his mind. And then on the second day, he encountered the lost child and had to go off the path to try to discover where this child came from and to get her back home safe again. And that night, as he recited the lines, he was concerned that he had remembered them accurately because he had been so distracted by all that had happened in the day before. And the third day, as he was traveling, he encountered a village that was in real trouble because their well had gone dry. And so they asked if he would go and get some help so that they would be able to be sustained. And so that night, he was really concerned about whether he was going to be able to recite the lines clearly. And each day, more and more distractions were coming along, and it was harder and harder for him to recite the message. And he finally landed upon the governor's house. He had a big confession. He said, "I have this message from the king, but I'm not sure how accurate it is, because after all, I've had all these days doing all of these things," and he recounted the journey that he was on and all the people in trouble that he had encountered and how he had to help them out, and that distracted him from remembering the message. And then the governor reached out to him and said, "There was a written message that was brought to me by another messenger, because there was concern about whether you would be able to remember all that you had encountered on the journey." And the letter, the message, was this: "My dear governor, there is great suffering in the land, but our people's hearts are hardened. I must find someone with eyes to see, a will to respond, and the courage to share the pain that lies about us, to act as my vicar. Pray tell that if you have such a person, and send him to me at all speed, for the time is short and the responsibility is heavy." The messenger looked up in confusion. His understanding grew, as the governor said, "Until you came, I had no such person to send, but now it is clear that you are he. Return to the royal service of your king, for you have brought the message 10 times over and far more clearly than ever you had rehearsed it." It tells the story of the core of our faith, that we're not called upon to have good and accurate theological statements or some kind of really fancy statement about the Christian faith, that we're about simply going out and doing the good things that need to be done in our world today. That's a message that was brought to us by John the Baptist, who taught about Jesus, that he was going to be coming. It's a message from Jesus and all those stories that we have in the gospel lessons, stories about the goodness of people and how God will bless them and care for them. And so in turn, it's a story for us, especially in this Christmas season, that as we bring our white gifts and give support to people who are in need, as we work together in our families to try to be more loving and caring and to be able to reach out in hope to them in their times of need, as we work together within the congregation to try to support and care for each other, that is the important message that we have from Jesus. And so today, we remember the message. We remember the message especially about how it's not about words. It's about being able to reach out and help all of those who are in need. We give thanks that that is our story of Christmas. Let us join together in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for the lessons that you bring to us. We thank you for John the Baptist and his story that someone who is greater is coming. And we thank you for the story of Jesus, the baby, so humble in a manger, that it was a message about how all are raised up and blessed. And dear God, we just hope that we are able to share that message within our church in these days, that it is about caring for all people, and holding every one up and seeing in the face of all around us the face of Jesus. Amen. And number 18, there's a voice in the wilderness, number 18. Spirit, to cleanse our hearts, to hallow our gifts, and to perfect the offering of ourselves to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We thank you for this family of our congregation
Help us as we work together. Help us to be able to see you in the face of everyone. We just thank you for the relationships that we have in this place. And, oh God, we thank you for the stories that are given to us by Jesus. They help us to see what is hopeful and meaningful within our world today, and that it gives great value to everyone who is gathered together. Dear God, we bring to you these are our prayers. In the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, as we do now in song.
Thank you.
share the peace of Christ with all you meet.
We share peace by acting out of compassion and not fear. We share peace by listening to all sides of the story. We share peace by praying for our world.
In this Advent season, we need to see, feel, and share peace as we go out into wonder into God's creations. Share peace and hope with those you need. Amen.